Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Cabinet for Health and Family Services. My name is Eric Clark. I'm the Chief of Staff for the Cabinet for Health and Family Services. And joined behind me are the executive leadership and management teams for all the departments and offices within our cabinet. We are honored to host our governor this morning as he provides an update on the major initiatives and achievements underway here at CHFS. I'd also like to recognize our former secretary, Vicki Yates Brown Glisson, who is also with us this morning, and take the moment to just give her appreciation for her service, the accomplishments she had under her leadership here, and also acknowledge the leadership team behind me that she built during her term here at CHFS. My understanding is the governor has now arrived. I will now turn it over to Governor Bevin, who's going to share his remarks and vision for our future. Good morning, Governor, and welcome.
Thank you all for being here. I appreciate it. This really is a chance to update you in many respects on all that is happening. You see a whole lot of the folks who work here, but especially those that are in sort of the leadership ranks. We wanted you to have a sense of who these folks are. Some of the questions we heard when Secretary Glisson decided that she was going to pursue an opportunity at a federal level. We were both happy and sad to hear of that, but wanted to acknowledge some of the great work that she has done. A lot of the questions that people's had is, well, what does that mean to the cabinet? What will be done with leadership? Are there projects she's working on that we're not going to be able to have finished? And we wanted to be able to address some of those things, what has been happening in the cabinet, but also to assure you that the CHFS is sort of like the Hotel California. You can check out any time you like, but you can never leave, really. So although she is going to be fully focused on her new pursuits, has absolutely agreed to be a resource to us, a sounding board to us, and will always be a friend to us. And to that end, we're confident that her great efforts will be able to be continued to the degree that they're necessary. There's five areas that I want to touch on briefly. And that is, first of all, just reminding you of the size and scope of this cabinet. It is the largest cabinet of any in state government. Well over 7,000 employees. That number has ranged over time, 8,000 employees. But this is a big cabinet. It covers things that you're aware of and things that you're not. The obvious things about taking care of the elderly and vulnerable children. But it also has oversight for things like restaurants and tattoo parlors and all sorts of things that may not normally be the things you think of when you think of CHFS. Birth and marriage certificates, just a whole slew of things that ultimately fall under the responsibility of those that are gathered around me. And again, I want to speak to, I think Eric, I did come in as he was just finishing. I want to make sure before we're done that you appreciate the folks that are here. Tim Feely, I think many of you know, he's been here as Deputy Secretary for quite some time. Others who've been instrumentally involved, we will give you the opportunity to ask questions in a moment of these folks. But these are people who oversee everything from the traditional CHFS side. Adria Johnson, where's Adria? Right here on the DCBS side, which is so many of the things I'm about to talk to here in a moment. The 1115 waiver is the second thing I want to speak to. I want to give you all in the media and those here the opportunity to both ask questions and answer them as it relates to what is going on with this 1115 waiver. You're aware of the fact, as we've done a press conference with you, that Kentucky is the first state in America to be given the opportunity to require something of able-bodied, working-aged Medicaid recipients. This doesn't apply to the traditional Medicaid recipients. And it's interesting, all the questions, well, what about the person who's already working? Doesn't apply. Well, what about the person who's disabled? Doesn't apply. Again, it doesn't apply to the vast majority of people that are on Medicaid, but there is a portion of them to whom it will apply. We can go into some of the details on that and give you an update as to how that's going. But the bottom line is, Adam Meyer and Christy Putnam, who are right here, these two, raise your hands real quickly. These two have been instrumentally involved, along with Secretary Glisson, from the beginning. All the meetings that we had, going back literally even to the previous presidential administration, for nearly 2 years, well over a year and a half, going to Washington, having a multitude of meetings both there and here, working through this process. The ability to see that assimilated now into what we're doing continues to be strong. Our confidence that this is going to be unfolded well is high. It is the confidence that the federal government has as well, which is part of why we were selected for this. The amount of work that has been done by all those behind me to ensure that this is implemented smoothly and effectively, and will ultimately then be a model for other states. There's a dozen other states now that are already interested in replicating the same thing or some variation of it. And I know for a fact that there are several other states that have not even applied that are thinking of doing so, just based on my conversations with their governors and our team's conversations with their teams as well. The opioid addiction is something I want to speak to because it really is, it's a crisis in America. It's certainly an epidemic here. In an epidemic, I've referenced this, in a video that I did, but people often use the term epidemic. What does epidemic even mean? An epidemic means when you just have more instances of something, typically health-related, than one would normally expect to have. Well, that is very much the case with the opioid crisis. We have significantly more people addicted to and frankly suffering from and increasingly overdosing on opioid and opioid-related drugs. Could be heroin, it could be fentanyl, it could be carfentanil. It has become epidemic. And so we want to, again, speak to and be willing and able to answer specific questions about what is being done to combat this. Among other things is in the budget that I just put forward a couple weeks ago, $34 million in this biennium that's being proposed to fight this epidemic. Is $34 million going to do it? There is no amount of money alone that's going to address this. But it is significantly more money than has ever been put into this. And it's going to be employed across four fronts that I'll talk about in a moment. There's really four facets of how you get your arms around this. But as I've said from the beginning, the key is you've got to close off the top of the funnel. The funnel of addiction is wide open right now. And people are falling into it. And there's no amount of money, there's no amount of programs, there's no number of beds available in Kentucky or anywhere to address this only if we deal with it at the bottom of the tunnel. This funnel of addiction, if we let everyone fall into it without closing off the top, we can't begin to address it at the bottom. So the key is how do we close that top of the funnel so that it's harder to get into this tunnel of addiction. And this is really tunnel, funnel, whatever you would call it. The bottom line is it is a process through which people fall, the end result of which is not good. But we have four categories, as I mentioned: prevention, treatment, recovery supports, and then harm reduction. How do you deal with those who truly are already addicted? And so I'll touch briefly on a couple of those things. This team, led by Secretary Glisson and others that are standing here behind me, fought hard to get a $10.3 million grant from the federal government specifically for the purpose of fighting against addiction. And that's something that we were awarded. I'm grateful for the fact that's in addition to the other monies that we've allocated in our budget or that we're calling for in our budget. Ultimately, the legislature will decide what is or isn't in there, but I believe that they recognize from everything my conversations with them, they recognize the need for this and the fact that we've got to make sure that we fight this. So we have $34 million in our budget, another $10.3 million that has been put in from this federal grant. Prevention, we've got to reverse this trend of addiction. So we have programs. We have a pilot program called START, which stands for Sobriety Treatment and Recovery Team. We've rolled it out in several counties now. And this is a way where you can intercede early where there's addiction in a home or the potential for addiction in a home, and there are children involved, and these children may be involved in other programs that we are providing. It could be Medicaid, it could be SNAP and TANF, other things where we now recognize that a family that is dependent on the state for certain basic needs also has addiction in the home. Who's going to suffer the most? The child is, frankly. The potential for neglect, the potential for abuse. is real. We've seen this. And so this START program is one that is intended to intercede early. And again, we'll be happy to address questions about that. But it's a pilot program that is starting to roll out, and we think will have a real profound impact as we move forward. We've taken a mobile van that we had that was a pharmacy-related van that belonged to CHFS, and we've repurposed that so that it now goes around to communities especially addicted by drugs and by overdosing, and is now disseminating Narcan and training people in how to use this drug. A Narcan is basically a drug that reverses the opioid overdose. And it's very simple, frankly, with a little bit of basic training to administer. But people being aware of it, knowing how and where to get a hold of it and how to apply it to save someone's life is important. And so that's something else that we have done. We've already distributed about 1,400 of these. We've had some great corporate sponsors like Aetna and others who have provided these free of charge to Kentucky to be able to be used and disseminated. Another area that I want to talk about is adoption and foster care. This is the fourth of the five things I was going to mention to you, then we'll open it up to your questions. Adoption and foster care is something very near and dear, not only to myself, to my wife, but also to everybody that's standing here behind me, to those that work here in this cabinet. I mean, we have now 8,500 plus young people, boys and girls, that are in our foster care system. We have over 2,400 of them that are fully eligible and desirous of being adopted. And yet the process to adopt still takes well over 30 months. It's, you know, somewhere between 2 and 3 years to follow the process. Some of you saw this emblazoned on the backs of T-shirts of the family that I had come during the State of the Commonwealth. The bottom line is it's too long. It's too bureaucratic. These are the types of things that have got to change. They just do. We'll get to this in a moment, but when you talk about cutting red tape, this is one of the examples we're talking about. Why is it so difficult? Why is it so time-consuming? So what are some of the things that we've done? Again, we've put $24 million in this budget to help address the funding needed to hire social workers and to pay the existing social workers more. Now, I will be very honest. Not every social worker that works for the Commonwealth of Kentucky is doing a good job. That's the sad reality. But the vast majority of them are. What we want to ensure is that those that are doing a good job are rewarded accordingly. That we remove and have the ability to remove those that are not doing a good job, to replace them with those that are. And so we have funding available to be able to hire not only more folks so that we can get caseloads down, but to be able to pay those folks we have more money. But we're not going to do that. This will take effect July 1. We're not going to do that until, to the best of our ability, we've been able to remove from positions those that should be removed and to put into position those that should be. It will be then that we worry about the pay compensation changing. But in the immediate term, we are starting the process of looking to broaden the number of people that we would hire. So that process of finding those folks is underway. It's critical. We've got to have the right people in the right seats on the bus in order for this to be effective. So we've put $24 million available for that in this budget. We also put $10.8 million in this budget specifically for foster and adoption programs. And again, the specifics of those will be unfolded as we move forward, and you'll be given information about that. But the bottom line is we're working with a whole lot of folks inside of state government and outside of state government, a number of organizations nationally who have focused on Kentucky, are grateful for the passion of those that are standing behind me and those who work in this cabinet. These are people who have said, we want to work with a state that is passionate about addressing this problem. And so this is exactly what they're doing. And so that money will be used to basically pilot and expand and scale existing programs and to come alongside outside resources. Many, many millions of dollars are being spent by outside organizations that are not even from Kentucky who want to help us pilot programs in this state that can be a model for others. This is an area that I'm convinced Kentucky can lead on. Kentucky doesn't do it as well as we could or as well as we should. But frankly, no state in America does. That's the sad and harsh reality. and millions of children are not as well taken care of as they might otherwise be. And we're determined to fix it here. And we're determined in fixing it here to be that model for others. Some of the things we've done already is just in the work that has been done with those youth in foster care. What are the things that are affecting them? We're starting to listen to their voices. And so you saw policy passed within the past year where now foster kids are able to get a driver's license. Used to be almost impossible for a child in foster care to get a driver's license. Well, that's brutal. Their ability to get a job and to be able to have some freedom and start to transition into the real world. Because when at 18, if they don't have a family, and most don't, they're just immediately out on their own without any preparation. Now, because of effort that has been made, they're now able to get driver's licenses when other kids can at 16. We've passed laws that address things called fictive kin. Fictive kin just simply means that a child has the ability to be taken in by a individual who is not a direct family member. Could be a coach, could be a teacher, could be somebody that's trusted, a friend of the family. Somebody who's able for a period of time to take that child in when normally the family would, but perhaps in that instance, the family cannot. The last thing, let me just touch on one other thing, too. There's several different websites I want to draw your attention to, websites and phone numbers. One specific to this area is there was a drive done that many of you are aware of to gather book bags and duffel bags and things that young people could carry their things in when they moved from one foster home to the next. What has sadly happened historically is that kids were given a big garbage bag, literally told, put all your stuff in the garbage bag, and they go out of their home with all of their worldly belongings in a black plastic garbage bag and move to their next home as they bounce from home to home. This has got to end, the movement. That's one thing. But the idea that a child doesn't even have the dignity of having a duffel bag or a suitcase. So a great effort was made, and so many people were very generous in contributing to that. And there are some who even now call in and say, how can we contribute duffel bags? How can we contribute suitcases? How can we contribute warm jackets and clothing for some of these children who are not properly attired? There's a phone number, 1-800-232-KIDS. 1-800-232-KIDS. If people want to help with these things I've just mentioned, if they want to volunteer their time and contribution efforts, just call 1-800-232-KIDS. I also want to draw your attention to a couple of websites that we've already highlighted previously, but this is as it relates to the drug overdose epidemic. The don'tletthemdie.com. Literally just don'tletthemdie.com, all spelled out as it sounds. We're now starting to make sure that that effort and a one that was running in parallel to it called findhelpnowky.org, findhelpnowky.org, they're now working together. Instead of having silos of efforts to deal with opioid crisis, going back now to that third point we were talking about, we're now starting to make sure that these various efforts that existed are talking to one another and that the one links to the next. We also put in place that 1-800 number for people who want to get help. And there's not enough times that you can put this out there through PSAs, through your news reports, or through our efforts to talk about it. It's 8338-KY-HELP. 8338-KY-HELP, which is 833-859-4357. 833-859-4357. That's where if you call, you can get a live person to help get you pointed towards somebody. If you have somebody who's addicted to drugs, somebody who's overdosed, and you don't know what to do, call 8338-KY-HELP, and somebody will help you with that. Again, all these things, a lot of information. But we're starting more than ever, instead of having these operate in silos, to have them work in concert with one another. The last thing I'll say, and then we'll open it up to questions that you may have. We talk about red tape reduction. We talk about simplifying the process. When I was elected a couple years ago and this team came into position, some of these folks were already here. But others in leadership have come just in the last couple of years. As folks moved into positions of leadership, it became clear that while we have a whole lot of regulation, and there's a good purpose for some of it. We wanted to make sure that there really was a necessity for all of it. And there were, at the time that I was elected, 669, I believe, let me check. Yeah, 669 regulations that governed everything that happens in this cabinet. We have reviewed all 669 of them. 110 of them have either been amended or repealed in their entirety. So out of 669 in this particular cabinet, 110 were either outdated or unnecessary. We'll continue to go through these as we move along. But the bottom line is we want to make sure that the regulations that are in place are adequate, that they're doing the job, that they're able to serve those who day in and day out are required to apply them. We want to make sure they're actually helping to create a healthier environment. So again, I wanted to use this opportunity to assure folks that the depth of this team is solid. It's as good or better than it's ever been. In large measure, the credit for this goes to our outgoing secretary, who's done such a great job of attracting and training and creating an environment in which these folks behind us can do their job. And I, you know, while this isn't the purpose of this, I will tell you, healthcare matters. Healthcare is critical. It's the nature of this conversation. We would do well to have a voice as experienced as hers in Washington. That's all I'm going to say that will sound political. But I'm telling you, the opportunity to upgrade there is significant. And this is a time in America when we need qualified, intelligent, thoughtful, experienced people to advocate on behalf of the American people from any district, anywhere. And certainly the 3rd District, which wrestles with so many of the things we're talking about right now, there would be very few, if any, people in Washington as conversant on a topic as critical as this as would Vicki Glisson. And so to that end, I truly am happy and sad, as I said at the outset. It's bittersweet, but I'm happy at the possibility for our state and for specifically the 3rd District to have a voice in Washington that would be able to speak to the things that she has shepherded now for 2 solid years. So let me stop there. Any questions that any of you have about these specific discussions and of any of the folks that are here behind me? Tom.
Governor, what's your timetable?
Again, I haven't even decided. This was something that it wasn't sudden. We had a lot of conversation that this was a possibility, but it wasn't a known. It wasn't a given until she decided she was really going to do it. And when she decided she was really going to do it, that now forces us to have to wrestle with that. I have no immediate plan to appoint a permanent secretary. I've got outstanding folks who are doing the work. Scott Brinkman, who is my cabinet secretary, who's right here, has been appointed as the acting secretary, which basically means he can sign off on those things that the secretary must sign off on. And in the meantime, again, I've got a wealth of experience and capability that's going to continue to do the job in the meantime.
Governor, Dan Dumas was your, I think your adoption czar, which is
yes.
I think you don't like, but we use anyway.
Yeah. It's because you used that I had to get rid of that position. No, it's your fault. If you wonder what happened to Dan, it's because you guys kept calling him the czar. No, here's the thing. Dan Dumas came in with all good intent and with great effort applied, but it became clear that what he was doing and what was needed didn't have a long-term proposition. It's why he had a contract that was able to be terminated at any point in time. He knew this. It's one of the reasons it had I don't know what the term would be, buyout type clause in there that some of you have picked up on, and it seems, you know, outrageous. But at the same time, this is the nature of these things. It was so that we were not stuck with a 3-year, 2-year, 1-year thing even. It was literally a day to day. And what he did was valuable. The amount of work that he did, the questions that were asked, the things that were done. Outstanding, but it becomes a point with anything, especially for people who are contracted to provide certain services to the state, whether it's in healthcare or anything else, that it is the responsibility of the administration and of myself as governor to look at whether the cost-benefit analysis continues to be worth it. There was absolutely need, there's still need in this area, but the team that's in place now is going to take work that he's done and that he's done in conjunction with them and independent of them and continue to move forward on this. So I'm sorry to see him go on the one hand, but on the other hand, the work that he did We got from him what we needed, and the value on a going forward point wasn't going to continue to be worth it, hence the need to no longer have that.
What did he do?
What he did is he went into every single cabinet. He met with people in every single department within the cabinet. He asked questions of why we do things the way we do them. He categorized for me the processes that we follow. He categorized for me the questions that were unknown as to why certain things existed. He met with inside groups and outside groups. He met with many of the, if not all, of the groups that want to work with and are working with Kentucky. Groups outside that are national in scope, and to work with them to coordinate their efforts with the cabinet. But again, at a certain point, a person who's in a consulting role, which is essentially what he was doing, is not the person who's going to do the job. The people that are going to do the job are the people that are behind me, and a whole bunch of other folks as well. So the gathering of the data, the categorizing of it, the categorizing of the questions, the identification of those things that did not have answers to them, and the realization that some answers we got weren't really good answers, that was the purpose. And I'm grateful for the fact that that has created an amazing amount of forward progress on this front and a whole lot of others. It's one of the reasons why the numbers that were put in this budget, the dollars that we've allocated, came from a lot of this information. Where would we put $10.8 million? It's going to be into some of these very things that I mentioned earlier. Other questions?
How will the transition in leadership affect the implementation of the 1115 waiver timeline and otherwise?
It's going to be irrelevant. I mean, and I say that it's with all due respect to anyone who would have been in this role. Secretary Glisson's job was to get the 1115 waiver approved, which she did. I mean, she and this team worked hard to make sure that it was actually approved. The implementation process was not something she was ever going to be involved in, nor will the person who comes in to that role. Nor even in the meantime will Secretary Brinkman. The real work will be done primarily probably by Christy and Adam as much as anybody and their teams shepherding this process. So it will continue to move forward just as it was intended to, and it involves thousands of people in this cabinet actually doing the work.
Related to that, if you would comment on the lawsuit that's been filed to try to stop this.
Again, is it the Southern Poverty League or whatever they're called? I mean, if people are not even from Kentucky. And this is just the kind of silliness. They get a few people who live in Kentucky to sort of be their face. But based on the comments made by those people, it's clear they're being used, and it's a shame. But this is what outside liberal groups do. They think they're going to come in and have make sport at the expense of Kentucky. Good luck to them. They'll lose.
Governor, your Narcan project you talked about earlier, 1,400 cases that were handed out. Is that handed out just to anybody, or is it just first responders and doctors?
No, they've primarily been given thus far to first responders. These are being, and again, I've done a couple of these training programs. Some of you have been at those. The program that we did with Aetna, for example, I think they provided 750 of those. In which we train first responders, people who will be using those. Ultimately, I think what you may find right now, Narcan and other iterations of it, is it naloxone? What's the naloxone? Is the kind of it's the more generic name to the drug. It has certain brand names like Narcan, but naloxone right now is a controlled drug. You can't just get it over the counter. That may change. I think you may see that's a federal level. We don't have any control over that. It's a federal level issue. I think you'll see that change. So ultimately, while it's right now primarily in the hands of first responders and healthcare professionals, I think the day and time will come where individuals will be able to find it available over the counter and keep it in their homes if they have a loved one who's addicted. Well, I mean, it'd be far more of the former. I think we have better programs than we've ever had. The question is, how do you have access to them? You have so many people addicted to drugs now, so many. And it doesn't know any socioeconomic constraints. I mean, it's literally every community. That you could have the wealthiest doctor to the homeless veteran under a bridge somewhere. I mean, every imagined person in your mind is quite capable of being addicted, sadly, to opioids and to opioid-related drugs. So the question is, in human physiology, I mean, one person is like another person. Once they're addicted, you would treat them in a similar way, and we know better and better ways of treating individuals. It's really the former part. How do you have enough beds? There are not enough beds, as I said earlier, not just in Kentucky, anywhere in America. There is not enough programming or dollars at the bottom end of the funnel. The real issue, the reason we're putting money into it, is to close off that top of the funnel of addiction. That's the real focus of the money. Yes, monies will also go toward dealing with those that are addicted, but if you can slow down the number that are coming out the bottom end, then ultimately the application of the existing programs will be able to have better effect. Right now it's just being overwhelmed by the numbers of people who are addicted. Other questions of me or of those behind me, of those that are going to be implementing the waiver? It really didn't have a profound, I mean, again, it's not going to even take effect until later this year. It really wasn't a major factor in the budget. It's being done irrespective of what the budget was. I mean, will it have some impact? Conceivably, over time. Short term, it's not going to be it may arguably cost more. I mean, the actual implementation process takes time and focus, and that costs money. The intent isn't to try to save money from a budgetary standpoint. It is projected that over 5 years, as people move up and out of the need for Medicaid, as they are given opportunity to get onto the on-ramp of the American dream through any number of avenues, that we project, and again, it's a pure guess, but as best we can guesstimate, about 95,000 people over the course of 5 years will either no longer need it or will have chosen not to participate. The argument, and this is, again, I would encourage you all, words matter. And you all very intentionally, I think, and very mistakenly, often use the words that people are being removed. Nobody is being removed from Medicaid. Nobody. Nobody's being kicked off or removed or losing access. There will be the access is there. There is now going to be responsibility for able-bodied, working-age people with no dependents to do certain things. But we can't force them to. This is a free country. People don't have to do it. If they choose not to, some of them would rather do nothing than something. That's their prerogative. This is a free country. If they choose to do nothing, they will potentially be among those in the 95,000. If they choose to do something, and as a result of that something, end up having better opportunities and increasing their chances to pursue the American dream, they will ultimately not qualify because they'll make too much money. That's a good problem. Again, not everyone leaving this is going to leave it under bad circumstances. In fact, they're going to leave only under two. Number one, because they don't need it anymore, which is great. Or number two, because they don't want to do anything in exchange for something of value. That's also good. So those proposed 95,000 would only be if, in fact, we have the success with the program that we believe that we will. And again, time will tell. But there's nothing directly related to the budget itself that's going to be made or broken as a result of this being implemented.
Governor, your budget, I know, lifts the moratorium on kinship care. Yep. I was wondering if you or Commissioner Johnson could talk about what that would look like.
Yeah, I mean, again, this is a variety of things, and there's monies that are budgeted now to pay for kinship care. Kinship care, in a nutshell, for those of you that are not familiar with it, just simply means that you have the ability as a family member under certain application process, I mean, not just anybody, but if you apply and you fulfill certain requirements, that family members can also receive some monies through the foster care program, essentially, for taking care of a family member. So a grandmother, you know, or an aunt or somebody might be able to receive monies for the caring for a child that is related to them, but for whom financially it would have been a burden. So that was something that used to be in place. The previous administration in this state got rid of it. It is now being reapplied, and there's monies in this budget. The process for which is being rolled out right now. I mean, we'll make sure that the people who qualify really do qualify, and that the monies are wisely applied. But there are many people for whom it's critical. I mean, they just don't have, they're willing to help raise their grandchildren, for example. But a few extra $100 a month makes a powerful, powerful difference. And so I've put the money in there, budgeted it to address this because, frankly, I think that's important. We want to make sure, above all else, the one thing I want to make clear, everything that happens in this cabinet has got to focus on, as it relates to children, has got to focus on what's best for the child first. Above all else, the child has to be first. And this is a challenge to those behind me, to those who work here, to those, every one of our social workers, to our judicial system, to all of them. The challenge is this. The child has got to trump the parents when it comes to what's best for that child, period. There is no amount of family whose interests are more important than that of the child. And that's a rethink on a way we've done a lot of things. This idea that the family and putting the child back in that family is the most important thing has led to a lot of problems. And we have a lot of children who have been put right back into very abusive and neglectful situations, and we've known it. Whether we'll admit it or not, we've known it. And we've known it because the laws require it. And so people know that they're putting a child back into a bad situation. Those rules have got to change. And that mindset has to change, and that's one thing we're working on. The child needs to come first. Other questions? Again, it's going to be programs, you know, like some of those that I've spelled out. It's going to be awareness. It's going to be these PSA things we've done now. We're doing these now in conjunction with various entities. Is it, who is it, LKY? WLKY in Louisville is doing a very concerted effort. And again, it's available to be used by any and all other stations. To basically PSA is to make sure that we help young people understand the dangers of starting down this path to addiction. That's one thing. So awareness is part of it, no question. Number two is these programs we've talked about, whether it's START, whether it's the training in things like Narcan, whether it's, you know, ultimately some of these are a response, but others at the front end, we want to make sure that in terms of the awareness, the 1-800 numbers, these types of things, that people can get information early and get to this before it becomes deadly.
And of those 110 regulations that were either updated or repealed, is there one that stands out to you as a good example of cutting that red tape?
I mean, I'll defer. You want to? I mean, Eric, why don't you? Eric is as the Chief of Staff for the Cabinet Secretary can speak better than I, and a guy who literally knows from personal experience what it's like to be in every facet of this cabinet. Why don't you speak to some of those that have been the most impactful?
Sure.
If you don't mind, that'd be great.
One that I like to share that I testified on before the BR Subcommittee on Human Resources, the House BR Subcommittee last week, is one of the things as we went through our regulations, we identified the need to partner with the General Assembly because many of our regulations are a product of statutes, and we have to implement those statutes through regulation. So one of the regulations we identified was our controlled schedules. We had five different regulations in Kentucky on the books identifying our different drug schedules. We also had state statutes that identified our drug schedules. We also had federal regulations that identified drug schedules. The federal law, the state statutes, and our state regulations were never in sync. They couldn't keep up with each other given the different drugs that were moving through the schedules over the years. So we had a bill last session. We worked with Representative Kim Moser out of Northern Kentucky to file House Bill 158 that allowed us to align our statutes and our regulations with the federal drug schedule. At the same time, we afforded the Commonwealth the opportunity to continue to schedule up drugs that we found were being identified for abuse and misuse in Kentucky, the ability to upschedule those in Kentucky so we can monitor those, control those, and prevent those from being abused going forward. So when that legislation passed, we aligned, we repealed those five different regulations. We now have one regulation on the books identifying our drug schedule, so the public can go to one regulation now, see our drug schedules, rather than having to weed through five different regulations to keep up.
Any other questions of anybody here? Thank you all. One more. Yes, Don, go ahead.
I got here late, so if you could kind of in a real...
We'll just start over for you, Don. It's all good. Yeah, no worries.
Kind of an overview of what you talked about.
Sure. I mean, the purpose of all this is to make clear that the cabinet, as it stands, is deep. The bench strength is solid. Our ability to implement the 1115 waiver is complete. We are sorry to see Secretary Glisson go, but we're excited for the possibility of Kentucky at the federal level to have somebody with her intellect and her knowledge in place of somebody who's just a bomb thrower. And I will say this, I mean, she's looking to run against a guy who throws out lots of adjectives. He talks about things like the 1115 waiver as being dangerous and irresponsible, but he doesn't explain what he means by that. He's sensational, and he adds no value. And if the people of Kentucky want somebody that will actually add value for us in Washington, they're going to have a better opportunity. So while we're sorry to see her go, the cabinet is strong, very strong.
Governor, while we have here, do you expect a pension bill this week?
I expect one. I mean, I've expected one for some time now. And it's interesting. You think about all of the conversation. Why did everybody not want to have a special session? Didn't want to waste $65,000 a day, right? How many days into the session are we? Multiply that times 65,000. Yes, I expect a pension bill. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.